Well, there's a lot on the line on the 4th of August 2019 as the British Challenge Cup gets in gear for the final race of the penultimate round of the season here at the Automotodrom Brno. Only 75 points remain after yesterday's stunning race, and what a performance it was by Fenton Sebright. However, Scott Ogden did manage to extend his lead over his main championship rival, Cameron Horsman, who had an absolute disaster of a day, did the number 23, finishing outside the points thanks for a mechanical. Unfortunately, sent Fenton Sebright, he kept his championship hopes alive, just although he does have company from Jack Nixon as well, who managed to take second place. It is all to play for with 75 points left on the table. Four riders could win this championship. There's three more races to go in the British Talent Cup for 2019. This is race two at Brno. Well, today's conditions are a stark contrast to what we had yesterday. Yesterday, it couldn't have been worse conditions for the riders out on track. Spray everywhere. It was completely and utterly sodden out on track. But blazing sunshine is gracing the Automotodrom Brno for this second race here. Will it be a runaway victory? We certainly hope not. Had enough of those today, haven't we? But we are ready to rock and roll. Plenty on the line for all these guys. My name's Matt Dunn. Alongside me, Fran Wild, ready to bring you this one. And it's nice to see Fran. Umbrellas on the grid. Not sheltering the riders from the rain, although no umbrella for this man, Fenton Sebright.
Yeah, apparently not on pole position. Like to keep it sunny, but yeah, the weather now incredibly different to what we had just a short few minutes ago for MotoGP, certainly for the start of that race. No spoilers if you've not seen any of it, but the sun now blasting down on this Brno circuit, and it looks like it should hold steady as well, so you can still see a few clouds, but nothing too menacing at the moment. And these guys now then getting seriously focused for what could be a pivotal race two here at the penultimate round.
Yep, some pre-race rituals going on for Brian Hart, who was the man to beat in free practice, that was for sure. But couldn't have been a more different story yesterday in the actual race. Brian Hart himself finished down in fifth place. He was just behind the championship leader, Scott Ogden, who managed to extend his lead and did actually look as though he was going to get a runaway second place. But no, he was reeled in very, very steadily. Towards the end of the race, a proper game of chess, some very mature heads on the shoulders of these riders yesterday in such difficult conditions. It was mighty impressive, though none more so than Fenton Sebright. Fran, let's talk about a little bit about him first. That was a really special victory, but he's done it before.
He has done it before. He tends to be a bit of a win or bin kind of rider, and certainly in the latter half of this season. Had a bit of a issue with consistency earlier on, which is why he does now have that 68-point, I believe, deficit to the championship leader, which really leaves them with a lot of work to do today, because obviously anyone who is more than 50 points behind Scott Ogden, the man you just saw on your screen by the end of today's race, is out of the running with two more races remaining at Silverstone. But Fenton, he's been impeccable and won with a commanding lead in the dry, and he did the same yesterday in awful conditions. And then we must talk about this man, Cameron Horsman, who had an absolute nightmare yesterday in the wet. He qualified on the second row and then dropped back and just seemed to keep losing time. And we wondered what exactly had gone on with the youngster, and it was unfortunately a bit of a problem with his bike that hampered his performance. And he did finish. He kept on focused on the race and kept putting the laps in, so he was able to keep going, but unfortunately was not able to score because, despite the crazy rain, we didn't have that much attrition.
No, we didn't, which was really good to see. Just the two crashes, one right at the end in the final lap, final corner, and it was through no fault of his own. But to put into perspective how dreadful that race went for Cameron Horsman, through real no fault of his own, Harry Lee started from pit lane, and even he overtook him to take that final point. And not even right at the end, it was well before the end.
It was, yeah, it really was a heartbreaker for Horsemen. And yeah, that definitely, that statistic lends a little light to the situation and how bad that must have been, trying to focus and push on. But he showed definitely his maturity in being able to do that, didn't give up by any means, and kept putting the laps in. So good to see in that perspective, from that point of view. But he is now 25 points down, which is of course an entire race win.
Yeah, absolutely, an entire race win, but 75 up for grabs. All he needs is basically, well, I say all he needs like it sounds easy, but he needs a good race full of drama, and his main championship rival Scott Ogden to have as nightmare of a race as he did yesterday, and then he should be back in the running with it. But Fenton Sebright will be one of those men looking to take as many points off those guys as much as possible. Likewise with Jack Nixon, who himself had a pretty good qualifying down in seventh place. He was the last guy within 0.8 of a second of the pole position man Fenton Sebright. He had some great pace too, but today's conditions entirely different.
Yeah, it will be interesting to see today, I think, because especially in the first two free practice sessions these guys had on Friday, which of course was a very nice day of weather here at this classic Czech circuit. It was actually Brian Hart, who starts second on the grid, who was the absolute class of the field the first two outings these guys had. It was over a second in the first session, and then still a sizable chunk of time he had in his pocket in the second to lead both of those, and then Fenton just pipped him in qualifying. So he could be pretty interesting now the conditions are something they're a little more used to, we'd say.
Yeah, and just behind him in on the grid is Reece Irvin, taking off in third on the grid. He actually finished third yesterday, which was actually a bit of a surprising result. He fell way back, then really just kept his head calm, hauled everyone back in, and then managed to grab that place. But unfortunately, it wasn't enough. Scott Ogden, who finished just behind him, that finish was high enough to bump Reece Irvin out of contention for the championship this year. But pressure's off.
It is. But Ogden, of course, that fourth place, very impressive given the pressure and the conditions, and it was the first time he was off the podium this season, which tells you an awful lot about how consistent he's been and how he's got himself into the position he is in. But then again, Cameron Horseman, the two non-points finishes that he's had, one DNF crash on the final lap that wasn't his fault earlier in the year, and then yesterday when he came home in 16th, they weren't his fault wholly either.
Yes.
So a bit of a difficult one to take for Horseman, but not taking anything away from Ogden. He's been pretty impeccable every time he's taken to the track, barring that bit of drama in Snetterton qualifying that left him at the back of the grid, but took two podiums, so no harm done.
It really showed that he can deal with any sort of pressure, and he really could yesterday, just after we had said, actually on the commentary, that he'll probably be taking it sensible and whatnot, not fighting back too much. Well, he got involved in a right big ding-dong battle. The star of yesterday was definitely Zach Shelton, who unfortunately is down in 19th place in the championship now. He was 18th. Not really used to seeing him up front, but he was second all the way until the final corner, where he got involved in an incident between Jack Nixon and Reece Irvin, their own sort of ding-dong battle, trying to go up the inside, real inside line of that final corner, unfortunately left him in the gravel.
It did, yeah. Just a bit of a tag for Shelton and brought that, what would have been an incredible fairy tale, to an end. And it's always a heartbreaker when it's so close to the end of the race, but especially when it's not, because he'd tried to make any move, really. He'd ridden a really, really incredible race up to that point, and a pretty sensible, defensive, solid last lap as well. He'd put himself right in the position he needed to be in, looked like he was safely through those two final corners until, yeah, that drama behind. And they weren't even really trying to attack him. So a bit of a heartbreaker for Shelton, but hopefully his confidence is high at this track, even though the conditions are different.
The thing we did miss out from yesterday, though, was Zach Shelton came all the way from the very back of the grid. That makes it even more impressive from the number 17. You could probably just see him just in the back of shot there, but this is your championship leader, the number 4 of Scott Ogden. Now on the warm-up lap, of course, no panic, we haven't missed the race start or anything like that. You can see the graphic on top of your screen. There was number 16, that was Harry Lee. Hopefully he'll get a better run of it today and not starting from pit lane like yesterday, that he wants to be avoiding that. Although, as we saw in the Moto3 race, no spoilers, not quite so much of an issue if you've got that level of determination.
Sometimes, yeah, you can just breeze on by as though it never happened. So, yeah, definitely recommend watching that Moto3 encounter from earlier in the day. If you do get a chance, you'll see exactly what we're on about. But Harry Lee, not quite able to make the same sort of gains yesterday, but like you said, today, hopefully, he will not have to do that at all.
Well, there you have the confirmation on your screens then. The only four men who could take this British Talent Cup title this year: Scott Ogden, Cameron Horseman, Fenton Sebright and Jack Nixon. Horseman, 25 points adrift. Sebright, 57 points adrift. And Jack Nixon, 68. Very unlikely that Jack Nixon would be able to get it. He would need some real disasters for the guys ahead of him for that. But, well, I'm sure he's probably put that to the back of his mind, just taking every race as it comes, because you just never know. Part of the reason why these guys line up every single Sunday that they possibly can. Not every single Sunday. That would be exhausting.
Not quite, but pretty close for some of them who also race in other championships back in the UK. Obviously, this is the British Talent Cup, but we do have a couple of overseas dates, as it were. One of them being here in Brno. In fact, yeah, this is the overseas date this year. Because Valencia obviously
was moved,
shuffled
it?
Around. So, yeah, they get a bit of an outing at this classic circuit. Last year, they had to go around Assen. So, all very good experience at Grand Prix tracks. But I think the two guys who will be thinking about the standings are going to be Ogden and Horseman. I imagine the likes of Seabright and Nixon are just going to be focused on the race and just know already that they just have to get the most out of that, regardless of what happens with the guys around them, because their shots at the title are very, very long.
Well, it sounds like, Fran, we've got the ingredients for an impeccable race coming up as they just give the brakes a little bit of a test there. That is Fenton Seabright, your pole position man, the number 22. What a performance that was from him. I cannot stress enough the dominance. We were concentrating a little bit more on the fight behind. Will we be concentrating more on the podium battle today? Or will it be all about the win? Well, we certainly hope so. There was number 9, Brian Hart, taking his position. Second on the grid, Rhys Irwin alongside him. Third. So the red man, the red flag man, pulls off across to the side. The lights are about to go red, and it's going to be Tally Ho, and away we go for the British Talent Cup. The final race in the penultimate round here at the Automotodrom of Brno. Who's going to get the whole shot down to the corner? Brian Hart looked like he had a good start there. Fenton Seabright alongside him. Who's going to click first, break into first corner? Oh, Cameron Horseman, the number 23. He's up in the second place, of course. Hopefully, no major issues with his machine today. But all safe and cleanly through turn one, it seems. But if Liberty's taken with track limits there by the number 15, that was reserving. Your man third yesterday. Right now, it's all about the slipstream as we go down into turn three.
It will be. I imagine this lap is going to see a few shuffles, and yet already Scott Ogden there proving me right. But Cameron Horseman, brave but sensible there off the second row to get himself initially into that second place. Brian Hart, it looked like he just got a little bit behind Seabright off the line, but obviously brought it back and took that whole shot. But it's Horseman in the lead, and I think Ogden, not quite. He didn't make it through on the number 9 of Brian Hart, but he's already looking for a way past that machine ahead of him. And as you'd expect, he will not want Horseman to disappear into the distance.
Yesterday's podium is currently sitting in position 4th, 5th and 6th, but there's going to be all changes. They go move up the inside. That was Rhys Irwin going up the inside of Jack Nixon there. Excellent move down into turn 7. A real problematic zone for quite a few riders in today's races and, of course, warm-up sessions, but plenty of rubber down on this circuit now. It's going to be seriously, seriously grippy, having just had the MotoGP bikes out on there.
Yeah, it's a bit of an interesting one this weekend with so many changes of conditions and the weather, and rubber gets put down and then the rain washes it away. But these guys just had some pretty prime conditions for racing now. As you can see, the sun, and like you just said, those big machines have just cleaned this track up nicely for them.
I think by this point yesterday, the field had well and truly strung out into a big long, I would say more of a freight train that was going rather slowly through its stations rather than thundering through, as these guys tend to be at the moment, much more close and compact today with these little pocket rockets going around. Of course, these guys ages from 12 up to 18 years old, a real variety in ages, experience, height and weight as well, etc.
Yeah, a lot is different between these guys in this field, but one thing is the same, and that is their will to win here in the British Talent Cup. So now we see them. Well, that's also true. I was going for a bit more corny, sort of old school video game feel, to be honest. But so we've seen Scott Ogden then just getting beaten up a little bit there. Looks like he's currently outside the podium places, although now we've come back onto the straight, I imagine he'll be looking to fight back. And it's Brian Hart who has again taken the lead. And I'm sure Horseman will be a little bit nervous about it being the number 9 ahead of him, because like we said, his pace in the dry on Friday in those free practice sessions was pretty scintillating.
Yes, it really was. Well, he won't want to let him get away, although I think, according to some of the Moto3 teams and riders, you can earn about 0.6 seconds here if you stay in the slipstream. So it's very, very difficult to actually get away. Plenty of Moto3 races, historically speaking, have been all about the slipstream and massive packs of riders all fighting for the leading positions. With Brian Hart, though, taking a very wide sweeping line there. We've got Fenton Seabright up through on the 23 there. Very cool and concise move down there. But now we're going out down to turn 5, all the way downhill. A lot of pressure on that front tyre as they're braking seriously hard down here. No crazy moves going into that one. Still very early stages here. 13 laps to go.
Yeah, it is early stages, like you say, but we do appear to have a bit of a breakaway top five. Have to keep a bit of an eye on it, but these five guys at the front at the moment look like they've just got the legs on those behind. Have to see how that changes across the race. And Brian Hart certainly not hanging about, and they're doing a great job at the moment in the lead of this race. And it looks like, few back lengths back to Horseman now.
There's our championship leader getting bumped back to sixth place. Scott Ogden there, Rizzo, and just taking his place from there. But is he going to fight back here? Down into Kevin Schwantz corner. He's pulling up the inside alongside him. Who's going to blink first? Ogden blinked later and has taken the place straight back from him. Now it's that long drag up the hill. Who's that ahead of him? Sorry, that would be Jack Nixon ahead of him. Did someone just have a twitch there, did I see?
Very big twitch.
Ooh,
and then
they just nearly touched
even
there.
More. I think it must have been Ogden then that had that twitch, and then you saw me twitch quite violently next to you. But yeah, a bit of a moment then for the championship leader. You'll just want to take a minute and take a deep breath and try and calm down after that, but no harm done. Apologies before, I couldn't count. I did mean six. So we've got these six guys, and then we have Fenton Sebright then attacking for the lead.
Yeah, look at this. Fenton Sebright finally making his move. The others will be hoping he's not going to do his disappearing act, which he is pretty good at doing in both wet and dry conditions. We saw it in Snetterton, the last round out in the first race. Number eight, that is that Oshin who's got the number eight? Sorry, yes, it's Edward O'Shea. Sorry, my apologies.
It's the Osh on the graphics. Yeah. It's easy to confuse.
That's what threw me off, of course. But number eight has a ride-through penalty. I'm assuming that was for jumping the start. We haven't... he has been given a jump start there. That came up simultaneously on our timing screens. But, disaster for him. That's a shame. But look at this. Brian Hart not letting Fenton Sebright get away. But that was the fastest lap of the race from Fenton Sebright. 2:15.364. Not quite as fast as his or Brian Hart's qualifying times from Friday, though.
Yeah, but obviously qualifying, a bit of a different kettle of fish, so that is some good pace from Sebright. And those two then just stretching their legs at the moment, and Jack Nixon has made his move up into third, but Horseman not too far behind at the moment. Ogden definitely the man who's just lost out a little bit with that twitch over the last couple of laps. Just seems like maybe today could be the day that the dry weather podium evades him, but we do have 12 laps to go.
Yes, we absolutely do, but the man who really needs to take all advantages that he can is Cameron Horseman, the man in second place in the championship. The number 23, though, has just been overtaken by Jack Nixon. He really needs to be getting these wins, 25 points down. If, for example, Scott Ogden finished second place to him, he's only gaining 5 points in him per race. He's not going to do it. So he needs to take all the points that he possibly can.
Yeah, he most definitely, if he's not going to win or even be on the podium, he at least needs to have an awful lot of guys in between him and Scott Ogden. And at the moment, it's either one or two as they squabble that out. So, not what Horseman will want to be reading on the timing screens. But we'll have to see how it evolves, because Ogden obviously probably eased off a little bit after that twitch. So we'll have to see what he's got in his pocket when he's back in his rhythm a little bit more.
I've got to say, Fran, that was a very exaggerated popping out the bubble there from Brian Hart. He was fully tucked in as possibly could, squeezing as much as he possibly could to get behind that tiny frame of the small Moto 300s. He burst out of there. It was almost like he was trying to avoid a bug or something.
Nice graphic description there. I enjoyed that a lot.
I don't think the viewers quite picked it up, so I wanted to describe exactly what it was like for them.
It's always better to have some British poetry rather than actual visual images on the TV.
I would make a terrible, terrible poet. No one would buy anything I wrote ever. But if we do have a little bit of a gap appearing here as well. They come in two by two, it seems, with Fenton Sebright retaking the lead from Brian Hart over the last lap. But Cameron Horseman burst through on Jack Nixon down into turn one. And wow, that's some corner speed he's holding there. A bit of a wider line he's taking to try and square off the exit as much as possible. Full gas here, getting the slipstream. There is Horseman ahead of Nixon, battling it out for third.
Yeah, Horseman had some beautiful moves at Snetterton. Managed to go round the outside a couple of times like everyone else was standing still. Almost a little bit, what?
I thought you were going to say like...
I wasn't going to make an Eminem reference.
Almost the exact same thing.
I was more actually going to say a little bit like Romano Fanati. Famed Moto3 rider, known for those really wide sweeping lines, which of course can leave you liable to a bit of an attack, but sometimes it really can be a spectacular way to just shoot straight around the outside of someone and they don't even know it's coming.
Well, absolutely. Well, just like race two in Snetterton, Fenton Sebright is unable at the moment to do his disappearing out. Brian Hart doing very well to stay with him. The lap times last time around, they're the only two riders in the 215, so they are a cut above the rest at the moment. But with Cameron Horsman having dispatched Jack Nixon for the time being, got a couple of bike lengths on him, be interesting to see how quick this lap is for him and whether he's able to start hunting those guys down. But I just got confused at who we're looking at then. I thought, wow, Jack Nixon got a really good drive out of that corner. He's already closed up. But no, it was Brian Hart.
Yeah, it's easy to do. I think when we've got this, like we said, two by two, it's which duo is this? But at the moment, we're looking at the two in the lead then. Sebright just looks a little bit more solid round here, but Brian Hart and Sebright now have a pretty comfortable gap back to the guys squabbling over third. So I think it's going to be an interesting one to see how this evolves, but so far there's nothing to say that it won't come down to a duel between these two on the timesheets in practice as well as today so far in the race.
Yeah, we've seen quite a few times in the Moto 3 World Championship this year a group has managed to get away at the front of about nine or so riders, and then about two-thirds distance or so the pursuing group has managed to catch them back up again. So it'll be interesting if that is able to happen here as well. These guys, although as they come across the finish line, we'll get a look at what their lap times are. High 2:15s from these guys again, and wow, a mid 2:16 from Horseman, so he's not catching them at all. Brian Hart moves up the inside again though, down into turn one.
Yeah, I was wondering if he's going to go a little bit wide there, but keeps it nice and tidy. And like we said, Horseman then, the man a little bit off the pace there, but so was Jack Nixon behind him. And it was Scott Ogden then that was the next fastest man up. So this could get pretty interesting. We have a long way to go, and this track is, you can see already, look then, in the background, Ogden attacking and on the scene of that duel already. 2-1.
Wow, that was a stunning move and a half down into turns 3 and 4. Wow, take a bow, Scott Ogden. That is why this man is leading the championship. That is some skill there from the 15-year-old. Absolutely brilliant stuff. Well, it looks as though it's not 2x2 anymore. That is a quartet. That's Reese Irwin just in the background there, the number 15, who took third yesterday.
Yeah, those two have put serious pedal to the metal, haven't they? And caught Horseman and Nixon. And Ogden, at least, is immediately past them and didn't seem to want to wait around. So that would tell you he probably thinks he's got the pace to pull away. And then Irwin there, a little bit of that patented Irish aggression going through. He's shown that a few times this season. Nothing too crazy, but always fairly spectacular, and I'm sure not so pleasant to be on the receiving end. And there he goes again up the inside. So looks like he's fairly keen then to stay on the coattails of Scott Ogden, and if those two have had that pace to close in so quickly, it's not so surprising.
Yes, I hear it's been a good day for other Irish Irwins over on the British mainland and British Superbikes. If you're wondering where some of the regular competitors here are this weekend, Scott Swan, for example, the number 20, used to seeing him well at the championship. He was in fifth place as coming into this round. He is on BSB duties in the Moto 3 championship they have there at Thruxton. And as I understand it, glorious weather there as it is here today makes a change.
Sounds unlikely, not going to lie.
Yeah.
No, so we can see then Horseman has got back past our Irwin, and these two still locked together at the front, but Horseman obviously knowing that he really cannot let Ogden get away. And Irwin, bit of a wild card in that mix, to be honest, because he doesn't really have that much to lose, but Horseman definitely, if he loses sight of Ogden and that points gap goes up yet again, it's going to be an even tougher hill to climb come Silverstone.
Well, Brian Hart was the only man who managed to do a 2:15 on that lap around, but the man with some real pace coming at it was Scott Ogden, a 2:16 flat. The next closest lap, well, here is, that is O'Shea coming to take his Raifu penalty, the number 8 for moving too quickly off the start finish line. It's been a long day.
Are you okay?
I'm trying to get my words out.
He made a jump start.
Yes, that's the phrase I was looking for. Edward O'Shea, of course, you will have seen those heartwarming scenes of him hit last time out at Snetterton with a coming together between him and Carvey Claridge. They had a nice hug it out afterwards between the respective 12-year-old and 14-year-old.
They did, yeah. Sportsmanship returned very, very quickly there, and all forgiven and move on. So O'Shea then rejoins the race. Bit of a heartbreaker, obviously, a ride through. Starting from pit lane is one kind of drama that Harry Lee had yesterday. A ride through, though, bit of a heartbreaker when the field's already broken up a bit and you just end up with so much more distance to try and make back up. But these guys at the moment, no distance whatsoever between them. Sebright still very much tagged onto the rear wheel of Brian Hart. And pretty similar lap times, a couple of tenths apart on that last lap around. But Ogden was on Sebright's pace, like you said, it's a 2:16 flat.
Nine laps to go, and it's worth noting that Brian Hart has only got got one podium so far this season, so no matter what happens, if he does finish his first or second, that would be his second podium of the season. But how much would he want that win? Fed to see Wright's had plenty. He doesn't need any more, but you know he's going to want it to assert his authority all over Brian Hart there. What is this we're about to see now? This is the final corner, isn't it? I believe it's just a glorious slow-mo shot there of the number 22.
I believe it is. Can't see much drama there.
Elbows out, somewhat Ben Spies style a little bit, but easily done with these smaller frame Moto3 bikes.
Easily done when you're a tall dude on a small Moto3 machine.
Ben Spies was a tall dude on many bikes.
So these guys then, nothing to choose between them, but it is a few seconds now back to Ogden, so although he was on similar pace, he does have a fair gap to make up. We've seen him do it before. Not sure if today is going to be the day. And I think Seabright then is going to prepare a move here and maybe take back the lead into turn one.
Ogden is responding, though, and all the riders behind them are responding. They finally, all the way back to Nixon in sixth place, have all managed to get into the 215s for the first time. So that pace is getting up. We'll be wondering what the front runners' pit boards are going to be saying over the next couple of laps, because it seems they are being closed down. Only slightly, though. I say slightly, but Ogden took a whole half a second out of them in that last lap, according to the lap times. So they are on the move, but I'm pretty sure if I was Scott Ogden, I'd be man-marking the person in second place in the championship, and that is a man right behind him, Cameron Horsman.
Like a netball final. Just don't let him go.
Nope, absolutely not.
Yeah, absolutely. Like you said, it was a fairly sizable chunk that took out of him, but that gap, you can see visibly on the screen, still nothing to be sniffed at. And I was wrong, obviously. That's what commentators are here to be. And Seabright did not attack into turn one, so Brian Hart remains the man in the lead then. It'll be interesting to see what happens if Ogden does continue to reel them in, and Seabright's aware of that. If he does have a bit of pace in his pocket, I'm sure he'll be soon attacking Brian Hart. But at the moment, he's not looking in too much of a hurry to get past the number nine.
No, he doesn't. He's probably just sitting there seeing what he's about and whatnot. He can't afford to give places away to him in terms of the championship, but, well, he can't really, because he needs to make all the ground that he possibly can. It's the same case for everybody. The only person who you could slightly argue can relax a little bit and just, in inverted commas, sit there would be Scott Ogden, but he can't really at all. He needs to keep those places as much as possible. Everyone wants to take everything off him that they can. If he gets into too much of a tussle and, heaven forbid, throws it down the road, Cameron Horsman just needs 25 points and he's back in the game.
Yeah, absolutely. And obviously, yeah, there would be a chance in that case for Horsman to equal Ogden. So it's still very much all up in the air, this British Talent Cup. But like you say, Scott Ogden is the man with a few decisions to make, but maybe a little bit calmer than some of those around him with that buffer that he has. But Horsman certainly not letting him go. And we'll have to see how this develops. I'm interested to see what their lap times are like next time around, and also whether these guys are going to start squabbling a bit. If Horsman doesn't think they're going to catch the leaders, is he going to start trying to beat Ogden up a little bit?
Well, he's moving out from the slipstream alongside Ogden. He was just pointing at him there or something or other, but he moves up the inside on whatever it is. Maybe he's going to tap his seat unit and tell him to go with him. We know exactly what Ogden's response will be if that's the case. He just had a look up the inside there from Rhys Irwin too. The wily Irishman wants a piece of this as well. But for the moment, Horsman stays in front of Ogden. But for how long?
I thought that was literally going to be it then. That looked very close from Irwin, but all kept it together. And Ogden then immediately responds and takes it back from Horsemen. So lap times last time around, yeah, they took another few tenths out of those two guys' lead, and it's down to 2.2 seconds now between Ogden and Seabright last time over the line.
Well, the hunt is on with seven laps to go. Do not go anywhere. You do not want to miss one little bit of this, that is for sure. Cameron Horsemen just staying behind Scott Ogden there for the time being. He's got some wicked corner speed down at the bottom of the hill there, but here is the big climb, and as it stands in this position, which we know it won't last, Cameron Horsemen 28 points adrift from Scott Ogden, Fenton Seabright 53 points, as opposed to what they've got, as I quickly swift over my notes. At the moment, it's only 57 points back to Fenton Seabright for Scott Ogden, so he'd only do a couple of points. He does need this win, really, Fran. He needs to take Brian Hart.
Yeah, he most definitely does. He is the man where it's a bit of a win or bin now as we get into the final few races of the season. Brian Hart, I don't know, it's the pressure of the first race win being on the table, but then obviously championship pressure, he doesn't have any at all. But it's going to be a pretty classic duel if it remains these two, I think. But those guys behind look pretty intent on making it a another little Moto3 freight train battle to the end.
Well, being the British talent cup and on the road to MotoGP program, you do have to wonder where these guys' heads will be at. Will they have these mature heads on their shoulders thinking about championships and whatnot? Are they so young that they want to win? They want to impress. This is the biggest stage they've been on yet this season in front of the MotoGP crowd. The MotoGP riders could well be watching this. I hope they haven't got the commentary on, that's for sure. But they could well be watching this. Here is your chance to make an impression. And Rhys Irwin is making an impression as he moves up the inside of Scott Ogden at the final corner. Here they come over the line. That gap is well and truly coming down, Fran. How far are they behind now? Just 2 seconds.
Yeah, 2 seconds dead then is that gap. And these three need to make sure they don't squabble and squander the pace advantage that they seem to have now. But that was an absolute classic Brno move from Irwin. Nicely done to get ahead of him, but he's already lost out and is back into fifth.
We missed that, didn't we? He's just looking at the onboard from Scott Ogden there. Completely missed it. Oh, it was all for nothing from Rhys Irwin for that moment. But Cameron Horsman is now the man into third place. This is not what they want to do per se. Having said that, there's such a wide variety of lines here, especially for these Moto3 bikes. This is one of the widest tracks they'll ever come to, and there are several lines which are just as fast as each other. Wow! Rhys Irwin just chopped in front of Scott Ogden there.
That was pretty spectacular and great timing from the onboard there. But yeah, Horsman, I imagine, will probably want to try and get these guys to tag on to the leaders as soon as possible, not only to fight for the win for himself, but to give a bit more chance of another rider getting ahead of or beating up Scott Ogden. But I don't know, they are squabbling a bit now. I don't think there'll be quite as an impressive lap time next time around from these guys, although they have settled down a little bit since Irwin made that bit of a cheeky. I don't know if it's cheeky, and there he goes again.
That was cheeky.
That was a little bit cheeky, but it was very nicely done. No contact, straight through, and the Irish back third place then. But Horsman will be well aware that this is not a guy he needs to fight in the championship, but that chance to catch the guys ahead of them is slowly ebbing away as we've got 6 laps to go after this one. They need to start getting in gear a little bit.
Well, as we focus on these guys on screen now, the man that is missing from that picture is Jack Nixon. He has been well and truly dispatched. He's 6 seconds adrift from the leaders, 4 seconds adrift from these guys that we're focusing on here. Behind him, though, there's a tasty little battle going on between Davis and then the other Hart, who is not brother of Brian Hart, I would like to point out. He is indeed Scottish. Charlie Farrer and then Atkins as well. That looks like a very, very tasty battle indeed.
Yeah, they're pretty close together, those guys. But I think these guys at the moment are stealing the limelight a little bit with this battle. But like you said, now we're going to get the lap times from this lap, and it will be very interesting to see, has that gap come down by half a tenth? Not very much.
Wow.
So it's not cost them too much, but I'm pretty sure that if they'd not had some of those moves on that last lap around, they could have taken another few tenths off the leaders' times. So keep an eye on that, but at the moment it's certainly very entertaining for viewers. If you're fairly neutral and don't have your bets on Ogden or Horsman, this is a great battle at the moment, and it looks like Ogden then is going to take back the Irishman ahead of him and tag back onto the rear of his biggest rival, Cameron Horsman. But I don't think Rhys Irwin will sit there for long, and no, he doesn't. Straight back through. Great move once again from the Irishman to take that place back. And Horsman at the moment then, just being able to stay out of that for a few corners. We'll have to see if he is able to take advantage of this squabble.
Yeah, at the moment, you can see it's like the proverbial greyhound to the rabbit. They are up ahead of them. They can see them. Cameron Horsman, his eyes will be fixed on that rear tail unit of Fenton Sebright. We have under 11 minutes, just over 10 minutes of racing left. What on earth is going to transpire here? This is far more exciting than we were experiencing yesterday at this present time, but it all exploded in the final couple of laps. It's been exploding all over the place here. Rhys Irwin up the inside, 2 for 1. How about that? What a move by him, but though he's gone quite wide. Cameron Horsman going to take him back as he there side by side coming down the hill. Who's going to blink first? Is it going to be Ogden going to go up for two or from the inside? No, they just stay in order there.
That was impressive stuff once again from Rhys Irwin. Not shy, is he? Not shy at all.
What Irishman is.
But yeah, these guys are in a great show at the moment. But like we said, that gap, they don't seem to have lost too much time. But yeah, the laps are ticking down now. 5 to go after this one. And we'll have to see how the gap has changed. But at the moment, me in this position, I wouldn't deal with it very well. I'd be sat in the likes of Cameron Horsman. I'd be sat there just yelling at them, can you please stop, we need to catch them. Well, but maybe with a few more interesting words thrown in there.
For that sake, Fran, I'm very glad that you're not on the bikes at the moment. Look at that, close as you like. They are just side by side through the corner. Scott Ogden are reserving. That would not be very popular. He's shaking his head there. He doesn't agree with that, does he? But, you know, racing is racing. No one rubbed there. It got very, very close, but there was no paint swapping whatsoever. However, that little move with four laps to go has just let Cameron Horseman eke out a little bit of a gap to them. How close is he to the guys in front? Still exactly the same gap as last time around. Unless he really gets a wriggle on, those two are gone.
Yeah, that was some close stuff there. Ogden, absolutely not for turning, was he there? Irwin looked like he got the move done, but the championship leader says absolutely not and kept it stuck in. But yeah, it's getting pretty feisty between them two now. But it will be interesting to see how quickly Ogden can close down Horseman, if indeed he can. Because you never know, could be a bit of tactics, keep him tied up in this battle here. And then and Horseman there, you see, tapping the back of his seat, saying, come on, let's catch them. He doesn't know he's got a fair bit of fresh air behind him now after that shenanigans.
I'm very glad he's not permanently looking behind him to see where they are, though. That's for sure. Focusing clearly very, very well focused on what's in front of him. Does it look as though that gap is coming down even more? Quite possibly. Horseman is edging out that gap. He's not edging out that gap. I misread the green there and the numbers. That gap between Horseman and Ogden's coming down.
The whole graphic.
But yes, the whole thing. But could he well be catching them down? We're getting caught out, what I am personally, by the camera angles here. It does look as though they're getting closer and closer. Brian Hart, though, he's got a couple of bike lengths on Fenton Sebright there, but you know Fenton could probably just turn that screw a little bit and get him back with these four laps to go. 10 minutes.
Yeah, I wouldn't doubt that at all, although, like you said, it's a little bit more fresh air between the two in the lead at the moment. I think it does look like Horseman's visually closer, although it's incredibly hard to tell. But Ogden and Irwin, then, you can see catching him back up, not easily, you know. But, you know, they've got their heads down and they've made some good headway over that lap to try and catch them 23 again. And there you can see Ogden now almost in striking range again. So we thought it could be a bit of a chance for the number 23 to break away there, but no, these guys are bane of his life at the moment in this race, straight back on him. But we'll have to see what the gap is to the leaders.
And getting a look at the leaders now, Brian Hart and Fenton Sebright. You can see just how crucial it is to have that slipstream coming up to this second half of the track, going all the way up that hill. That slipstream just saves so much time. Fenton Sebright right on the back of Brian Hart again, just 1/10 between them. But what's the gap to those guys ahead? They are closing in. 1.7 seconds now between Horseman and Sebright, and Ogden is going all the way with him.
Yeah, he most definitely is. Looks like Rhys Irwin then starting to struggle a little bit to stay with those guys, and I think just in the back of shot there you can see the Irishman take a brief look behind him, so maybe he is aware that he's not going to be able to run this pace, or maybe he's just double checking who they've got for company. And Ogden then straight past Horseman once he's arrived on the scene. I think it's going to be interesting to see what he's got in his pocket, given the ease with which he did close down the man ahead of him, but could also be a bit of a tactic, you know. All he's got to beat is Horseman.
The only man in that lap on a 2:15, and it wasn't just a 2:15, it was a 2:15.4. The leader did a 2:16.3. Horseman was only 6/10 behind him as well. That was serious pace. Who's that number 21 down in the gravel? That's Ross Maguire, the Scotsman. Oh, what a shame. No points for him last time out in Snetterton. And there's another crash for him there, but he's fortunately okay. Thumbs up to the marshals.
Yeah, it's good to see, obviously, immediately up and away from that crash. Bit of a heartbreaker, so close to the end of the race, but good to see that he is okay and will doubtlessly be fine again for Silverstone and the season finale. So these two guys then, track limits, guys.
We're taking
on
a few liberties there.
Green stuff is not for racing on unless you need some real get-out-of-jail-free cards, but no harm done at the moment. We've not seen them abuse them too much, and it is when you start kind of purposefully gaining an advantage that race direction will come down harder on you. So we'll have to see, but I think that gap does look now a little bit smaller again.
That is very much smaller. That is so visibly. They can almost smell them. Just up ahead of them, they can smell the exhaust fumes coming out the back of their bikes as we thunder up the hill now, and they've got each other to work with. Fenton Sebright right on the back of Brian Hart, and then Cameron Horseman right on the back of Scott Ogden. We're into the final complex here. It will be two laps to go after this, the penultimate lap of the penultimate round. Well, this is going to get very, very tasty indeed. Look at that. Who was that going up the inside there? That was Davis going up the inside of Atkins for seventh place. We just saw a shift down there. What are the gaps now? Lifetime has not changed.
That was an absolute heartbreaker.
What an absolute anticlimax. Come on, there we go. They come across the line. Whoa. Oh, he's
think we have a problem.
Yeah, we do have a problem because Brian Hart's gone, but he's there.
His transponder maybe has a bit of an issue.
Aliens are taking him.
Confused the system, but you can see on the graphic as well, so hopefully we'll get that back soon. But I don't think we actually need it anymore because we can just look at the screen. They are.
Forget it. This is a quartet
there.
Now. No more 2x2. This is well and truly a quartet. The race is on. These are three guys in the championship fight. Unfortunately for Jack Nixon, he will be out of the championship fight after this one, well and truly. But Brian Hart, the real wild card in this quartet, the man who's going to be very interesting indeed if anybody is going to try and take that lead off him. There he is. He's back in the lead on the times as well. But
returned from that brief abduction to lead once again. But so these guys absolutely line astern now. And like you said, Brian Hart, nothing to lose in this. Fenton Seawright, maybe a little bit more, but almost nothing because it is such a long shot and he can only keep that really alive by winning and continuing to win in the final three races. Don't know what the guys behind are going to do though. Horseman obviously needs to finish ahead of Ogden, but Ogden, I would say, you know, maybe he'll play it safe because he's a championship leader, but it's not really the playbook we've
but
seen from them before this season.
Yeah, they are 17 years old. They do not want to play it safe whatsoever. They have no real interest in that. This is the biggest stage possible. Well, that's what I like to think anyways, for the sake of the drama for Brian Hart there. Well, he was absolutely awesome through that first and second sector or so. Really pulled out a good lead. But just as we're coming up the hill again, though, he's been clawed back in by all these guys. They come back together. A real interesting yo-yo effect here. So clearly he's got a little bit gain on them there. What are they going to do coming out of the final sector into the final complex? It looks like Horseman's lining up. Ogden for a move up the inside here into turn 13. Yes, he is. Is he going up the inside? Yes. And he's left Ogden no room to give him an answer either. Meanwhile, Fenton Seabright, do you think he knows these guys are there?
I'm not sure because they have arrived fairly quickly, haven't they? So it'd be interesting to know, but I'm sure we'll find out after the race. Horseman then, that was his last chance at a bit of a rehearsal. And good move from him to get back in here. And it looks like it's all going down to this first corner
now. It really is. We have a new leader, Scott Ogden. Oh, it's absolutely messed up live timing completely. Scott Ogden is in the lead from Brian Hart. How about that? And Cameron Horseman in third, fed to see Brian fourth. I don't think these guys had any idea what's happening. Three abreast down the straight there. This is the last lap. Oh, Frank can't cope. Her head's in her hands. She's already got it. My heart's going already. This is what it's all about, the British Talent Cup.
Yeah, this is a classic race already. These four guys then, it looked like they were a bit surprised, weren't they? Brian Hart and Fenton Seawright see these guys right with them and they didn't waste any time at all in attacking. And it's Horseman now then that holds the advantage at the moment. And it'd be interesting to see now what happens with these.
This is what he needs to do, Cameron Horseman. He needs that win. He needs to close down Scott Ogden. He's got to hope that Brian Hart and Fenton Seabright are going to mess him around as much as possible. But his only problem is Brian Hart has full intentions of messing him around. He wants that second podium. He wants that first win, probably more than any of these guys here. They've all had wins. Most of them have been on the podium most rounds, or they've been dipped. Brian Hart going up the inside. No, he's not this time.
Horseman super defensive. Really, really solid so far from the number 23 under fairly extreme pressure from Brian Hart. Like you said, Hart really will want to take this win. It looks like he's attacking already again now. Can Horseman keep it? He can.
Ooh, super, that was cool
super
on the
solid.
Brakes.
Yeah.
Very, very cool on the brakes there. I thought he was going to do a full Darren Binder and just watch when the other guy breaks and then break a little bit harder. They come up the hill now. This is the drag. The final sector. Brian Hart looking up the inside, but he's got Scott Ogden for company. Horseman just keeps it there. Meanwhile, look at that. Fenton Seabright, wise head on Young's shoulders, just watching where everything's going. He's going to hope these guys are going to get all involved into the final corner. It's the final drag, slipstream. What's going to happen? You can barely even see the other guys. There's four riders coming into this final turn. Is it Ogden up the inside? It is. He's only going to take Brian Hart, or is he? Wow, Cameron Horseman maintaining the lead there. It's all about that drag to the line. Here they come. Thigh-slapping stuff. This is the British Talent Cup, the final race of the penultimate round. And Cameron Horseman has done exactly what he needed to do. He takes the win from Brian Hart. And Scott Ogden filling out the podium. Fenton Seabright, a cool move, but unfortunately I think that's his championship hopes done. Horseman keeps them alive.
Yeah, absolutely stunning stuff from Cameron Horseman there. So solid, just keeping everything together and absolutely nailed that final lap to the number 23. And these guys are all in a pretty close battle as well. Is that okay? I think it's celebration. I was wondering if it was a little bit of beef.
Yes.
But nothing too dramatic then. It was I spoke too soon.
Crash out of a final corner. Who is that, unfortunately? Oh, that's not Zach Shelton.
Oh,
It's actually, his weekend goes from bad to worse. He looks dejected. Fortunately, he's up and okay. Poor fella. That was absolutely heartbreaking yesterday, wasn't it? And just looking at, is that another rider? No, that's him looking back from a different camera angle.
I think
thank
it's
goodness.
A different camera, yeah.
Yes, it is, yes.
Heartbreak for Shelton then, twice in a weekend. But nothing can take away from that incredible race that he had yesterday there. Like we said, came to an end through no fault of his own. But some serious shuffles there in the final stages. Like we saw Rhys Irwin just dropping back off that battle for the win in the latter stages. And then we had an incredibly tight gaggle of riders from 6th all the way down to 10th. And it was Charlie Atkins who ultimately got that.
Oh no! Oh, Zach Shelton has just been a victim twice in the final corner from another rider. That is absolutely heartbreaking. That poor kid. I want to leave the commentary box and go give him a hug.
Honestly, how bad can your luck be at Brno?
That is bad luck, isn't it? That
truly,
is absolutely
truly bad
luck.
Because both times, you know, he hadn't gone crazily wide. He hadn't really made a mistake or anything. And just awful to see. Poor Zach Shelton.
No wonder he looked dejected.
I know. I mean, he just looked a bit done with it, really, didn't he?
I mean, I am too.
Honestly.
For him.
Hopefully, we'll see him have a little bit more luck next time out at Silverstone. Because, really awful way to end the weekend and the second race. So let's see a bit of this drama then that eventually saw Cameron Horseman take the win. Super, super solid round there he was. Absolutely nothing anyone could do. And it was just behind him, though, that shuffle did occur.
I thought we were looking at this specific race winning overtake.
I think
this is a compilation almost.
It is. So this is the onboard then of watching Horseman just sweep through. And... yeah, he's been solid and super smooth, really unflappable as Horseman this season. And that was vintage number 23 there. And Brian Hart then keeping second place just about. But great battle between these four.
Yeah, the what we said might happen at the beginning of the race did actually happen. It might have been 2x2 for a while, but eventually they came back together, working together for this beautiful quartet. And what a win that was from Cameron Horseman. Really great to see. That was proper skill and strategy there. He knew exactly what he had to do, and he went and done it. That is really bringing in a star of the future.
Yeah, that was a really, really good ride. Like we said, Horseman has been really good. Yeah, I keep saying really great. Need to find a new word, really. But a very impressive season from Horseman this year. Like we said, the two DNFs, not his fault. So it would feel very good, I imagine, to have taken that win, to have taken it in a fairly good style as well, with some solid tactics and a solid head on mature shoulders. But Ogden, again, back on the podium. That's what he needs to do as well. And Brian Hart taking that second podium. That's good as well. And what have we
What's
got
he
here?
Doing?
Hopefully,
he's helping him put his helm, the visor up, I think. Or get his glove off or something like that. He definitely wasn't giving him grief, that's
oh,
for
no,
sure.
Oh, no, absolutely not. But, you could tell immediately it wasn't that.
No, no. But yes, the rear, of course, that does leave only three men, or maybe not actually. No, Fenton Seawright will be out of the championship fight as well, with he by my mass.
I think
50
he may
points
well
he
be.
Needs. He needed to get it below 50 points, so that'll be him well and truly out. It will be a two horse race going into the final round. It is down to Cameron Horseman and, of course, Scott Ogden. What a ride that was. That was a brilliant race. What a great race to finish off the day of Grand Prix racing that we've had here with perhaps some of the stars from the British Isles of the future.
Indeed, that's exactly what it's designed to do, the British Talent Cup. And Cameron Horseman and Scott Ogden this season overall have certainly put on an incredible show.
Might be worth at this point in time doing a bit of promotion for the Asia Talent Cup. The selection, well, you can still put your entry in for the selection. Which when does it close, fan? Do
you know? It's very, very
close
soon.
Very
so
soon.
You
get
need
it
to
in.
Hurry.
This could be you, kind of. Well, here are the final results then. Cameron Horseman takes the win by just over a tenth of a second from Brian Hart. Scott Ogden in third from Fenton Seabright in fourth. Has his championship hopes out and out of the wind. Rhys Irwin couldn't quite hang on then, and I've completely run out of time from that result sheet there. I'll go through on the actual one. Then Charlie Atkins, Farah, Nixon and Davis fill out the top nine. Jack Hart, no relation to Brian Hart, of course, finishes tenth from Harvey Claridge. Corey Tinker, Harry Lee, and the likes of Lyons, Jones and O'Shea, who carried out that jump start and ride through penalty. He's there bringing up the rear in 16th. But what does that do to the championship? Minus 16 points to Cameron Horsman. It is all to play for at Silverstone. Fenton Sebright and Jack Nixon, they are out of contention well and truly now, but they will just be going for wins, 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 getting all involved. There's pride on the line here and race wins and potential. Well, Moto3 rides another championships, that's for sure. And some more shifting in the championship standings lower down as well. And poor Zach Shelton remains in 19th after that double DNF through no fault of his own. Well, when this ends, I think that'll be one of our first ports of call to go and find him.
Indeed, and I can confirm, getting past my paranoia, it's the 11th of August for the Asia Talent Cup registration. We've got another week till Austrian GP Sunday. If you are interested to, definitely have a look and see if you meet the criteria. You can find everything on www.asiatalentcup.com. So nice and easy to find. And these guys then, bit of a post-race debrief. I'm liking that style. That
are they trying to decide whose trophy
Hart.
Is whose?
Well, I think that's why we had a race.
Yeah, that was done. It's already decided.
You see three tall guys then.
They are very
Moto3
tall.
Machines.
I think they're taller than both you and
definitely,
I are, mate, Fran.
I think maybe, to be honest.
I'd make a better Moto3 rider with my size.
Yeah, definitely. That's why you've already had a glittering career.
That's why I'm in the commentary box. My racing expertise and back and history. Just kidding, of course.
Are you Steve Day?
No, I don't have the quiff for that. But there we are then. Coming on to the podium, Scott Ogden, third place for him. He did kind of what he needed to do. He needed
a
podium.
He will have just wanted a podium, I think, as a minimum to, you know, sleep tonight fairly well and go home satisfied. Obviously, he'll always want to win. But couldn't quite get that done today, certainly without some pretty crazy risks. And then Cameron Horsman, he really needed the win, and he got it.
Yeah, fourth win of the year for him, the most out of any other rider here in the series so far this year. So even if he doesn't win the overall cup, he has the most wins as it stands. Two more races left to go, though, of course.
He can be the Danny Pedrosa of 2012.
Niche. There he is, Cameron Horsman, lifting the trophy. And I guess it's time for his national anthem as well. Shortly, there. Last time we heard God Save the Queen was in 2016 when John McPhee and Cal Crutchlow took their respective Grand Prix victories here.
I just back you up on that stat off air and I've just realised we heard it yesterday.
Yes, we did, of course, but I mean here in general.
But, on Sunday, certainly, on a race Sunday. So great to see, and join us for the final round of the season. Like you see, round 6, Silverstone alongside the British Grand Prix in a few weeks' time.
Yes, what an event that'll be alongside the British Grand Prix. I believe we'll be getting some highlights fairly soon from that one, and there were plenty of them. Interesting to see what the editors have picked from this one. There we go, off the line, and what a start that was from both Fenton Sebright and Brian Hart. Some solid moves all the way up inside Scott Ogden there. He had a real rough around of it, and he came from quite far back as well. Jack Nixon was up there throughout the race for the large part of it in the early stages, but then fell back all the way back, unfortunately, to 8th place. But there is Scott Ogden with one of his moves up the inside of Cameron Horsman, the eventual winner. Meanwhile, Brian Hart and Fenton Sebright were out making hay up the road.
They had a sizable advantage with the duo at the front for most of that race, but in those final few laps, that chasing group there was able to just turn the screw and reel them in and ultimately take them on and defeat at least one of them, with Sebright then off the podium. I believe this is the race-winning overtake, is it not? No, it's not. It's just the same on board.
Yeah, well, we saw plenty of stunning moves all throughout the race. Reserving there in the background, he was an ever-present figure until he unfortunately was dropped by the two championship contenders as well. Fair play to him. What a race weekend he's had with that third yesterday as well. But it was all about these guys. Keeping our eye on them whilst Brian Hart and Sebright Bright making hay out front, but they did manage to turn a screw, drop into those 2.15s in order to actually catch them towards the end. Coming into the final laps then, it seemed, they were on the hunt and closing in, and this is when the group became that quartet again.
It did, yeah. So by this point, Irwin was a little bit further back in the distance, and it was the two championship contenders, Seawright with his long shot and Brian Hart desperate for that first win. And we had three abreast at one point and some spectacular moves in the last couple of laps.
Yes, we really, really did. What a section of racing that was. And coming into the final sector, then you could barely even see the guys behind Cameron Horseman then. What a race that was. And what a line he had through that final complex as well. Absolutely no way these guys were getting up the inside of him there. And across the line they come. Well, without further ado then, I guess you must join us for Silverstone in a few weeks' time. It's the final round. Who's going to win? One of these two on screen there, Cameron Horseman or Scott Ogden. It's advantage Scott Ogden at the moment, just, but Cameron could well take it from him. Join us in a couple of weeks' time.